Hachette Digital presents Strong Women by Roberta Kray. Read by Annie Aldington.
Chapter 1. Jo Strong gazed down at the sheet of paper. There was nothing new typed on it. Nothing she hadn't read before. But the words still made her stomach turn over. It was almost 2 years now, and the notes kept on arriving with unnerving regularity.
"You know what I think," Carla said.
Jo's sister-in-law had her back to her and was standing by the sink, her plump hips gently swaying to a song on the radio. As such, Jo felt safe in raising her eyes to the ceiling. It was a gesture born of resignation rather than anything more hostile. She knew what was coming next.
"It's pure nastiness, that's all. Rip it up and chuck it in the bin."
Carla looked over her shoulder.
"Put it where it belongs. You have to move on. It's what Peter would have wanted."
"Would he?" Jo frowned. Surely if what the writer claimed was true, that might not be the case. But then again, how could it be true? It was a question she often asked herself, but which she no longer repeated out loud. Two mugs were placed on the table. It was her kitchen, but whenever Carla came round, she always made the coffee. This had started shortly after Peter had died and had somehow grown into a habit. Pulling out a chair, Carla sat down and nodded towards the note.
"You shouldn't even open them. What's the point? It's just some sad old cow who gets her kicks out of tormenting people. How many has it been now?"
"A few."
"More than that. And you know what the cops said."
Jo shrugged. She wound a strand of pale blonde hair behind her ear. She remembered exactly what the police had said, even though it was 18 months since she'd last talked to them. They'd been keen at first, taking the letters away for analysis. But when they'd found no fingerprints, no clues, their interest had soon waned. "A crank," one of them had suggested. And then, 4 weeks later, when she'd taken the latest communication down to the station, a pasty-faced sergeant had looked her up and down.
"Do you have a computer, Mrs. Strong?"
It had taken a moment for the implication to sink in.
"They thought it was me," Jo said, still astounded after all this time.
"They thought I was writing them myself, that I was some kind of neurotic, grief-stricken, attention-seeking widow who couldn't accept the findings of the inquest." Carla shook her head.
"I'm sure they didn't, love, not really. No one who knows you could ever. I mean, it's just ridiculous."
"Try telling that to Sergeant Hannon." Jo could still recall her initial burst of indignation at the policeman, followed by the anger and humiliation. A light flush rose to her cheeks. Even now the memory had the power to upset her. She had turned on her heel and walked out. She hadn't been back since.
"You have to stop reading them," Carla said briskly. "It isn't good for you. Whoever she is, she'll get sick of it eventually."
"What makes you so sure it's a woman?"
"It usually is. They're more spiteful than men, more persistent."
"Maybe." Jo lifted the mug to her lips, blew on the surface and took a sip of her coffee. "Unless it's a double bluff. Someone who wants me to think that." Carla raised her brows. As soon as Jo had said it, she wished that she hadn't. She didn't want her to know just how much she dwelled on it all. "You're right. I should get rid." Standing up, she grabbed the note and its envelope, walked across the kitchen and dropped them in the bin. She would retrieve them later, after her sister-in-law had gone. She would put them in the drawer with the other 22. Eventually she would find out who was doing this, and when she did, she intended to have the evidence to confront them with.
"Best place for it," Carla said approvingly.
Jo sat down again and swiftly changed the subject. "So how are the kids?" as Carla embarked on what was likely to be a long and detailed account of the achievements of 12-year-old Mitch and his younger sister Lily, Jo smiled absently. She was fond of them both, but today her thoughts were elsewhere. Her gaze drifted towards the window. The flat was a first-floor conversion in an old Victorian house on Barley Road. The front rooms, well-proportioned and bright, overlooked Kelston Green. The green was not as grand as it sounded, about twice the size of a football pitch. It was really no more than a basic expanse of grass, with a central concreted path, several wooden benches, and a few spindly trees and bushes dotted around the perimeter. At the moment it was almost empty. Only three boys, dressed identically in grey hooded tops, jeans and pricey trainers, leaned idly against their bikes. But in a few hours, when the trains and buses discharged their cargo of commuters, it would be heaving. How many times had she watched Peter walk across? If she half closed her eyes, she could almost imagine him striding towards her now. Jo quickly blinked the image away. On the far side of the green was the high street, with its organic food stalls, its fancy designer outlets and overpriced coffee shops. Kelston was one of those East London boroughs nestled between Bethnal Green and Shoreditch, which had recently been discovered by the middle classes. The old and the new, the dilapidated high-rises and the smart executive homes, the well-off and the struggling coexisted, although not always in a state of harmony. Relations between the residents gently simmered and occasionally threatened to boil over. Her gaze shifted to the red pillar box along the road. All the letters had been posted locally, maybe even there, right under her nose. Could her unwanted correspondent be one of her neighbours? Could it be someone she saw every day? Maybe even someone she spoke to? Her mouth began to dry. She had considered moving away, but couldn't quite find the will to do it. To sell the flat would mean leaving a part of Peter behind, and she wasn't ready for that yet.
Not that he's the slightest bit interested in anything I have to say.
Jo caught the end of the sentence and guiltily refocused her attention. Despite missing the start of the complaint, she had no doubt as to whom Carla was referring. Her husband, Tony, was, to put it mildly, a philandering drunk. And it had all got much worse recently. She reached out a hand and touched her lightly on the wrist. Are you okay? Carla forced a weak smile before she subtly withdrew her arm. She was a giver of sympathy, not a receiver.
I'm fine. Don't worry about me.
Expelling one of her familiar sighs, she slowly rose to her feet.
I'd better make a move. I'll see you on Sunday, unless the old witch has croaked by then. Not that we'd be ever so lucky. You are coming, aren't you?
Jo pulled a face. She looked forward to these monthly lunches with the same level of enthusiasm she reserved for the mail dropping through the door. Ruby Strong was a sly, bitter old woman and a bully to boot. Unfortunately, she was also Peter's mother.
Please say you'll be there. I can't cope on my own.
She had been thinking about making an excuse, any excuse, to get out of it. But seeing Carla's growing look of horror, she didn't have the heart to abandon her. She knew what it was like to be at the receiving end of Ruby's relentless snipes and criticisms.
Of course I will. Thank God for that.
After they'd said their goodbyes, Jo stood by the window and watched as she walked along the street and climbed into the brand new, gleaming red Toyota. Carla, she noted, had her own pricey way of making a husband pay for his infidelities. When the car was out of sight, she turned, flipped open the bin, and plucked out the letter and its envelope. She took them over to the table and straightened out the creases. The note was soggy, stained brown by lying on wet tea bags. She was not entirely convinced that the letters were intended to be hurtful. Yes, they were anonymous. Yes, they were disturbing. But were they actually malicious? Jo stared down at the limp sheet of paper. The typed words, read so many times before, were already seared into her heart. Your husband's death was not an accident. Chapter 2. The speckled hen was at the end of a short cobbled alley running off the high street. They'd managed to find a table in the busy courtyard garden, and the evening air, retaining the heat from a glorious June afternoon, smelled of hot dust, exhaust fumes, and spicy cooking. Laura had called in the afternoon.
"Are you free tonight?" "Please say you are. Something's happened. I have to talk to you."
So here they were. And if Jo thought she had problems, they were rapidly paling into insignificance.
"This is him," Laura said.
Jo put down her glass and picked up the small black and white photograph. The man who returned her gaze was on the wrong side of 40, with the frown lines to prove it. It wasn't a handsome face, but one that in a dim light might just pass for interesting. "How did you ever get involved with him?"
"Don't ask," Laura said. "It was a big mistake and one I haven't stopped regretting since."
She sank her head into her hands.
"It was a moment of madness. I mean, what was I thinking? I should have had more sense than to get entangled with the likes of Gabe Miller. I'm such a bloody fool."
Jo shook her head. "Don't beat yourself up about it. It's like you said, you just made a mistake."
"Not the kind of mistake that the senior partners are ever going to forgive me for. I'm supposed to be a lawyer, for God's sake. Number one rule, never get personally involved with the clients, and especially not with a lowlife like Miller. If I want to save my job, my career, I've got to get that laptop back. It's got all my files on it, all the information about my cases. Apart from the fact that I need the damn thing, how am I going to explain how it's gone missing? The bastard even took my memory stick."
"You could just tell them it had been stolen." Laura gave a low, frustrated groan.
"Yes, I could. If it hadn't been gone 2 days already. It's too late now. If I suddenly report it as stolen, it's going to look suspicious. I'm either going to have to explain exactly how, where and when it was taken, and my sleeping with Gabe Miller is hardly going to go down too well with the bosses. Or lie about it. And if I lie about it and the cops start asking difficult questions, then..."
"It could be a bluff. Are you sure he's serious?" Laura's fingers tightened around her glass.
"Oh, he's that all right. When it comes to payback, no one's more serious than Gabe Miller. He knew I was on the brink of finishing with him, and he doesn't take kindly to being dumped. He wants $2,000 or he's going to stroll into the office with my laptop and make sure the whole firm knows about our little liaison."
"Blackmail," Jo said softly.
"It's not that he even needs the money. It's just revenge or control, or whatever it is that drives that twisted brain of his. So what choice do I have? I've already agreed to pay."
Jo frowned. "But even if you do, that won't stop him from coming back for more."
"I know. And he could still tell the world, but I don't think he will. Once I've got the laptop, he won't have any solid evidence. It's all password protected."
"So, when are you seeing him?"
"I'm not. At least, I won't be if it all goes according to plan."
"But I thought..." The corners of Laura's mouth curled up.
"I said that I'd agreed to pay. I didn't say that I meant it. As it happens, I've had a much better idea. He's staying at that new hotel near Euston, the Lumiere. I've arranged to meet him in the bar tomorrow night at 7.
"And then?" Jo said tentatively. She had the feeling that she wasn't going to like what was coming next. Laura James had what could only be described as an impulsive nature. An interesting trait in some respects. She could never be described as boring, but one that was almost guaranteed to get her into trouble.
"And then, while he's waiting for me, I'm going to go to his room and snatch the laptop back."
"What?" Jo's response was so loud that a couple at a nearby table turned their heads to look. She quickly lowered her voice.
"You must be kidding. You're going to do what?"
"It's the only way. He won't have it on him. I know he won't. He likes to play games. He'll want to try and screw with my head for as long as he can. Nothing's ever simple or straightforward with him."
"But you can't break in," Jo insisted. "I mean, apart from anything else, What if you get caught? In fact, you will get caught. That kind of hotel's bound to have cameras, CCTV.
Who said anything about breaking in?
Jo stared back at her.
I've thought it through, Laura explained, and I'm sure it'll work. Once Miller's safely in the bar, I can turn up at reception with some fancy luggage and claim that I'm his wife. So long as I look the part, so long as I'm suitably dressed and utterly charming, why shouldn't they let me into his room?
Jo opened her mouth to object, but then smartly closed it again. It was true that Laura could be extremely persuasive when she put her mind to it. With her long auburn hair and hazel eyes, she was also stunningly attractive. A bonus when it came to fooling any unsuspecting person on a hotel desk, especially if they were male.
He'll have a double room, Laura continued. He always does, just in case he gets lucky. I'll say that there must have been some misunderstanding over the booking, that it should have been for Mr. and Mrs. Miller. I'll be disgustingly polite and sweetly patient. I'll even ask them to ring up and check with him if necessary. But of course he won't be there. He'll be in the bar waiting for me.
And if they still say no?
They won't.
They might, Jo said. You can't take it for granted. Security can be tight in these places. What if they ask for identification?
Laura shrugged. You know me. I'll think of something.
Jo finished her wine, reached for the bottle, and quickly refilled their glasses. This wasn't a plan they should even be discussing. The whole idea was crazy. Or was it? Perhaps not completely crazy, but it was hardly foolproof.
There must be a better way of dealing with this. Any suggestions?
Jo hadn't. Coming clean clearly wasn't an option. From what she'd gathered about Laura's bosses, they were hardly the forgiving sort.
But it's so risky. Even if you do manage to get into his room, how can you be sure he won't catch you in the act?
What if he gets tired of waiting, realises you're not going to turn up and comes back and finds you there?
Quite, Laura said. That's why I could do with some help.
She dropped her gaze to the table and slowly looked up again. Her eyes were pleading.
It's a big favour, a huge one. But I was wondering... Well, I was wondering if you could keep him occupied while I'm getting into the room. We're only talking 15 minutes, 20 max. I wouldn't ask, I really wouldn't, unless I was desperate.
Jo had no doubt as to the state of her desperation. What she did have doubts about, however, was her ability to keep Miller occupied for 5 minutes. Never mind 20. Since Peter had died, she hadn't even glanced at another man. Her seduction skills, such as they were, had been placed firmly on ice.
I don't think I can. All you'll have to do is chat to him.
Chat him up, you mean? Laura gave a small, brittle laugh.
Oh, believe me, he'll be the one doing the chatting up. All you'll have to do is pretend to be interested. If you're sitting alone at the bar, it won't take him long to notice you. He'll make a move.
And if he doesn't?
Of course he will. God, Jo, don't you ever look in the mirror. You're young, slim and blonde. You have the face of an angel. And there's nothing Miller likes more than corrupting the innocent. He won't be able to resist. He'll be all over you.
Jo wasn't quite so confident. At 28, she no longer felt especially innocent. And her resistibility factor, on a sliding scale of 1 to 10, could well be into double figures.
But if he's expecting you at any minute... That won't stop him. Anyway, I'll give him a call. Tell him that I'm going to be late. That way, he'll think he has some time to kill. And Gabe always likes to use his time usefully.
Jo hesitated, twisting the glass between her fingers. She wanted to help. She really wanted to say yes. But a voice of caution was still whispering in her ear.
What if it all goes wrong? Forget it, Laura said. I shouldn't have asked. You've got your own problems. You don't need me adding to them.
But if there was one thing Jo valued, it was loyalty. They might only have known each other a few months, but it was long enough for the friendship to become firmly established.
after all the darkness, all the grieving over Peter, Laura had finally brought some fun and laughter back into her life. To say there was never a dull moment was a complete understatement. Her friend had shown that there was more to this world than pain and misery, or stressing over Ruby Strong's unfavourable opinion of her. So maybe it was time to give something back in return. And, if she was being honest, the idea of preventing a seedy, blackmailing Romeo from profiting from his sins had a certain appeal. Laura's plan might be slightly dishonest, even marginally illegal, but it couldn't be said to be immoral. Taking a large gulp of wine, Jo swallowed it down. She breathed in deeply and slowly exhaled. "Okay," she said. "Count me in. I'll do it." Chapter 3. The cab turned off the Euston Road and 20 seconds later drew up beside the entrance to the Lumiere. It was 7:05. Jo got out, stumbling in her haste. She quickly stood up straight and then waited as Laura calmly picked up her Louis Vuitton overnight bag, glided onto the pavement and leaned over to pay the driver. They stood in silence as the taxi pulled away. Laura smiled at her.
"Are you okay?"
Jo's nerves were on edge, her stomach turning somersaults, but it was too late to back out now, even if she wanted to.
"Just about."
Laura smoothed down the skirt of her cream designer suit.
"You'll be fine," she said. "Are you sure I look the part?"
"Every inch. You're positively oozing sophistication."
"Fingers crossed that our friends inside are of the same opinion."
She got out her phone.
"You go on in. He should be there by now. I'll make the call."
Jo nodded.
"Good luck," she said.
Then, before her courage could fail her, she turned, walked up the steps, and quickly pushed through the revolving doors. She'd never been inside before, and the foyer was as bright and spacious as the hotel's name suggested. It was also, she was pleased to discover, exceedingly busy. Laura's plan had a better chance of succeeding if the front desk was under pressure. Her heels clicked along the smooth marble floor. She followed the signs to the bar, pausing just before she reached it to check her reflection in one of the fancy gilt-edged mirrors. All things considered, she hadn't scrubbed up too badly. The simple navy dress was short but not too revealing. The single string of pearls was classy but not ostentatious. Her makeup was intact. It was only as she touched the nape of her neck that her face abruptly fell. The skin felt too bare, too naked. It was over 3 months since she'd decided to cut off her long hair, and she still hadn't got used to it. Jo attempted to smile, but her mouth had begun to tremble. She imagined a big arrow pointed towards her head with "liar" written in bold black print at its end. What if he saw straight through her? What if he realised what she was up to? To try and bolster her confidence, she ran through the plan again. It was simple enough. All she had to do was go to the bar, find Miller, and take a seat close by. She was just a nice girl waiting for a friend who was late. If Laura was right about his predatory nature, then he would do the rest. As soon as Laura had got the laptop, as soon as she'd left the hotel and hailed a cab, she'd call on the mobile. 20 minutes max. Then it was merely a case of making her excuses. Simple, wasn't it? She walked slowly round the corner. Her legs had begun to feel leaden. She stopped by the door to the bar. It was crowded inside, humming with pre-dinner activity. The lighting was subdued, the music an upbeat rhythmic jazz. For a second, assailed by another wave of anxiety, she stood by the entrance, absorbing the mingling smells of perfume, aftershave, and early evening cocktails. She felt frozen. She couldn't do it. But she had to. Rapidly, she scanned the room. What if he wasn't here? She almost hoped he wouldn't be. But then, as her gaze jumped from table to table, she suddenly saw him. The man in the photograph made flesh. The despicable Gabe Miller. He wasn't at a table, but was sitting at the far end of the bar where it curved into shadow, nursing what appeared to be a glass of whiskey. "Come on," she urged. "Move." By now, Laura could already be in the lift, ascending towards his floor. Before she could become completely paralysed, Jo forced herself forward. At the bar, she was careful to keep a discreet, but not too generous, a distance between them. After clambering up onto one of the chrome high-back stools, an ungainly struggle that rather questioned her credentials as a woman of elegance, she smiled at the barman. He had a name tag on his chest that identified him as Giorgio.
"Good evening, madam."
"A dry white wine, please." While she waited, she allowed her gaze to drift casually towards Miller. He was dressed in a good quality grey suit, white shirt and tie. His shoulders were broad, and she guessed from the length of his legs that he must be over 6 foot tall. His dark brown hair was cut short and brushed back from his forehead. The best that could be said of his face was that it had been lived in. He was in need of a shave, a bluish tinge shadowing the high, sharp cheekbones, and his nose had been broken more than once. His mouth was thin and faintly cruel. Jo tried not to stare. Had he noticed her? No, not even a glimmer of interest. He was more beguiled by the contents of his glass than by her feminine charms. So much for her sex appeal. But then, just when she'd given up, he raised his eyes and gave her a cool, assessing look. Success! She almost jumped off her seat. It was a kick. She couldn't deny it. A brief rush of adrenaline pumped through her body. Her instinct was to look away, but that wasn't what she was here for. Instead, she held his gaze for those few requisite seconds, enough to establish an interest without appearing too keen, enough to suggest that, should the circumstances be right, she might just be approachable. Her drink arrived, and she rummaged in her bag, giving him plenty of time to intervene, to offer to pay. Except he didn't. Disappointed, she took a fiver from her purse and passed it across the bar. "Thank you." "So what now?" Jo returned her attention to the room. It had that distinctive Friday night feeling. The atmosphere was imbued with a heady, almost reckless air, as if the working week was a dragon temporarily slain, its resurrection still 2 clear and hopeful days away. In the meantime, anything could happen. Except it didn't appear to be happening to her. Almost 10 minutes had passed since she'd first entered the hotel. Only another 10 to go. She was drinking too fast, too nervously. She was halfway through the glass of wine and he still hadn't made an approach. On a personal level, it wasn't doing much for her ego. On a more practical one, she was growing increasingly anxious that he might get up and leave. It was only when he looked at his watch for the third time that Jo decided she had to do something. Leaning across, she said, "Excuse me, but is there another bar in this hotel?" He raised his head slowly.
"I don't believe so."
His voice was deep and husky. She wondered if it was naturally seductive or simply the product of a bad chain-smoking habit. "Oh, right," she said. "Thank you."
"Are you waiting for someone?"
"Well, I thought I was, but..." Miller nodded. His eyes, which she had presumed from the photo were brown, were actually a dark, almost charcoal shade of grey. Their scrutiny seemed more pitying than predatory.
"Sorry."
Jo stared at him. "Sorry? What kind of a response was that?" She waited, but he made no further comment. He'd already returned his attention to his glass, and there was only a mouthful left. She fought off a frown. Sympathy was bad enough, but utter indifference was 100 times worse. Was she really that undesirable? She felt like giving up, like walking away, but knew that she mustn't. "I could be in the wrong place." Miller looked up again, his dark brows lifting a fraction.
"Well, we've all been there at one time or another. I wouldn't worry about it."
Jo realised that he thought she'd been stood up, that she was here on a date rather than waiting for a girlfriend. Still, so long as he was talking to her, it didn't really matter what he thought. She may as well play along. "Easy for you to say, Mr..." He leaned across and put out his hand. Gabe. Gabe Miller. It was only as his fingers squeezed hers that she realised she hadn't thought of a suitable pseudonym. Bearing in mind the circumstances, it would hardly be smart to provide him with her real identity. Her brain scrabbled for an alternative. Helen Seymour, she finally blurted out. The name of a girl she'd been at school with.
Nice to meet you, Helen.
His hand held onto hers for a little longer than was strictly necessary.
And yes, although I hate to admit it, it's happened to me more often than I care to dwell on.
Joe smiled. I hope you're not trying to make me feel sorry for you. Isn't this supposed to be my moment of supreme humiliation?
No need to be selfish, and I don't suppose you have much to worry about. He probably just got overexcited and stepped out in front of a car.
She laughed. There's a thought worth holding on to. He lifted his empty glass.
Would you care to join me?
Unwilling to appear too enthusiastic, she took a few seconds to pretend to think about it. All right, then. Why not? Miller ordered the drinks. When they arrived, he stood up, paid for them, and then sat down a little closer to her. He chinked his glass against hers.
To absent friends.
I'm not sure I should toast to that. A girl has her dignity to consider.
An overrated virtue, he said, along with modesty, purity and...
Honesty, she suggested, thinking about the laptop, about how he was blackmailing Laura. Miller shrugged.
I don't object to honesty. In its place.
She tried to keep the contempt from her voice. And what place would that be exactly? His gaze slid down to the wedding ring on her finger. God, she'd forgotten all about it. Joe suddenly realised what was going through his mind. A rosy flush suffused her cheeks. He didn't just think she was on a date, but that she was cheating on her husband too. I'm not, she began, but then stopped abruptly. She didn't have to explain herself to this lousy scumbag. She glanced at the clock behind the bar. Time was almost up.
I wasn't passing judgment, he said.
She nodded and quickly changed the subject. I've never been to this bar before. Are you staying in the hotel?
Just for the night.
His accent was hard to pin down. She tried to figure it out, but there was nothing distinctive about it. A hint of London, perhaps, but a more neutral, smoothed-out version. Business or pleasure?
Business, he said. Although I've never been averse to combining the two.
As if to add unnecessary emphasis to the statement, his eyes made a fast, lecherous sweep from her face to her breasts, down the length of her legs and back up again. Joe felt herself stiffen under his gaze. The guy had about as much subtlety as a randy teenager. And here was me believing it was only women who could multitask. He grinned.
You'd be surprised.
And so would he, she thought smugly, if he had any idea of what she was really doing here. So, what brings you to London? What line of work are you in?
This and that, he said evasively. And you?
Oh, much the same, she replied, playing him at his own game.
There's a coincidence.
Joe sipped her wine. What was Laura doing? She should have called by now. The 20 minutes had come and gone. How long did it take to search a room? Something must have gone wrong. Perhaps Miller had the laptop with him. She looked down at the floor, scanning the space around his feet. But it wasn't there. She began to have visions of Laura being arrested, of being led away by the police in handcuffs.
Are you all right? He said.
She looked up brightly. Fine, she said. Why shouldn't I be?
I don't know. You just seem a little...
Suddenly she heard the series of beeps that heralded an incoming message. Reaching into her bag, she pulled out the phone. Excuse me, she said. Keeping the screen shielded from him, she eagerly read the text. It was from Laura. Got it. Time to go. She read it again, relief streaming through her.
Good news, he said.
Yes, I guess so. I'm afraid I have to go. Miller pulled a face.
Good news for you, maybe.
Jo smiled as she got to her feet. Sorry, but thanks for the drink.
A pleasure, he said. Give me a call if you ever find yourself at a loose end.
He took out his wallet and produced a small white card. It had only his name and mobile number printed in it. No address and no occupation. She dropped it into her bag with the phone. I will, she lied. It took every inch of her willpower to walk from the room without breaking into a run. Chapter 4 Jo hurried across the foyer, pushed through the door and clattered down the steps. She was awash with a stream of nervous elation, the kind of rush that made her want to jump up and down and laugh out loud. All they had to do now was to make their getaway before Miller discovered the laptop was missing. She ground to a halt on the pavement, her high spirits giving way to a confused surprise. The black cab should be idling by the entrance, but it wasn't. Frowning, she scoured the street. No sign. The plan had been to meet again outside the hotel. She was sure of it. She walked a few yards and then retraced her steps. She unzipped her bag and got out her phone. Almost immediately, it began to ring. It was Laura. Hey, Jo said, smiling again. Where are you?
I'm really sorry, but something's come up. An urgent call from work. I've had to take off.
Work? Jo repeated. Her face fell. What?
It's a client. Some idiot who's got himself in trouble. Thanks for everything. You're a real darling. I don't know what I'd have done without you.
You've gone? Jo said. She gazed stupidly up and down the street again.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to leave you stranded. I feel like a real bitch, but you know what it's like. I couldn't say no. Just grab a cab and I'll pay you back when I see you.
You haven't even told me how it went. Laura's voice sounded impatient.
Great, perfect. It went like a dream. You're a real mate. Look, I'm almost there. I've got to go. I'll give you a buzz tomorrow and fill you in on all the details.
But I thought we were supposed to be...
Jo didn't get to the end of the sentence. The line was already dead. She put the phone back in her bag. Her disappointment at the lack of any victory celebration was coupled with a deeper sense of irritation. Why couldn't Laura have waited for a few minutes? It wasn't much to ask after what she'd just done for her. And somehow the whole work thing didn't quite ring true. Laura wouldn't have been on call tonight. Not when she'd planned all this. But there was no time to dwell on that now. It wasn't smart to hang around. She might bump into Miller again, and that wasn't a prospect that appealed. Jo set off at a brisk pace, keeping her eyes peeled for an empty cab. The evening air had a chill in it, and she wished she'd brought a coat. Her high-heeled shoes, more suitable for posing than walking, were beginning to pinch her feet. She cut down onto Euston Road and was almost at the station when she heard the shout behind her.
Hey!
Jo didn't react. This was London, and people were always raising their voices. It was only as she became aware of footsteps pounding the pavement that she glanced over her shoulder.
Oh no! Gabe Miller was racing towards her! Her stomach barely had time to sink before he had grabbed hold of her elbows and shoved her roughly back against the wall.
Very smart. Very cute, he snarled. You want to tell me where she is?
She stared back at him, her eyes widening with alarm.
What?
Skip the innocent act, Helen.
He squeezed his hands together around her arms and pushed his face into hers.
Where is she?
I don't know who you're talking about.
Don't give me that crap.
His eyes were blazing, and the pressure from his fingers was painful.
You're hurting me,
she said, trying to pull away. But his grip only tightened.
Tell me,
he demanded again. Jo was growing seriously afraid. He looked like he wanted to kill her. People were passing by, a few of them giving curious glances, but nobody, as was so often the case in the city, seemed willing to intervene. If she wanted help, she was probably going to have to scream for it. She opened her mouth, intending to do just that, when he suddenly let go. He took a step back and groaned. Jesus, he said. Still softly swearing, He tore his fingers through his hair and began to pace in front of her. 3 steps to the left, 3 steps to the right.
Have you any idea of what you've done?
Jo rubbed at her arms. Coming from a blackmailer, that seemed kind of rich. But it was hardly a point to start debating at this particular moment. She had more important things to worry about. Gabe Miller was clearly a bad loser, a man who didn't like his victims turning the tables. Twisted. Wasn't that how Laura had described him? She was beginning to understand what she meant.
I really have no...
Don't even go there, he said. I don't want to hear it.
He stopped pacing and glared at her. I've just been robbed. Doesn't that bother you at all? She stared silently back at him.
Please don't do this, he said.
His voice had turned curiously pleading. He raised his hands and dropped them again.
Look, whatever you've been paid, I'll double it. It'll be just between you and me, no one else. I promise. Just tell me where she is.
Nobody paid me, Jo croaked.
Miller stood in front of her, his wild eyes staring into hers.
Don't you see what this makes you? A bloody accessory.
So call the cops, she snapped back.
Her indignation abruptly reviving what little was left of her courage. As soon as she'd spoken, she wished she hadn't. His expression grew even blacker. She wanted to believe that nothing truly bad could happen to her in a public place, but that was a hope that was gradually diminishing.
You'll regret it, he said.
This has got nothing to do with me.
The fuck it hasn't.
As she tried to walk away, Miller grabbed hold of her arm again. Jo struggled to free herself.
Leave me alone!
He jerked her closer, his hot whiskey breath in her face.
As soon as you tell me who paid you to play Matahari.
For God's sake, she protested. It's only a laptop.
What?
You had no right to take it in the first place, and I'm sure it won't take you long to find someone else to blackmail.
Miller instantly released her arm, stood back and laughed. It was a bleak, empty kind of sound.
Blackmail?
He rolled his eyes towards the heavens.
Get real. Shit. You can't really be that stupid.
Jo didn't know what he meant, and she wasn't prepared to stay and find out. The sooner she got away from him, the better. Finally freed from his grasp, she started walking down the street.
Fine, he called out after her. You do that. You take off. But don't think he won't find you. And when he does, he's going to blame you just as much as me.
The words stopped her dead in her tracks.
He?
Jo said, turning to look at him.
Who are you talking about?
Miller shook his head.
You go on home, sweetheart, and pour yourself a stiff drink. You'll need it.
He paused.
Only make sure you lock all the doors and don't say I didn't warn you.
Jo swallowed hard.
He was just winding her up. He had to be.
Laura had got her laptop back, and he couldn't deal with it. Except there was something worryingly real about the fear in his eyes. The skin around his cheekbones had tightened, and his face was gaunt and grey.
What's that supposed to mean?
He took a step closer.
That you're in as much damn trouble as I am?
I don't think so.
Oh, yes. Your partner in crime is long gone. They're probably miles away by now. And they've left you to pick up the pieces. They've landed you well and truly in the shit.
Joe's mouth fell open.
Surely Laura couldn't have... It's only a laptop. Why should anyone...
There is no laptop, he said, his voice rising again. This has nothing to do with any bloody laptop. Can't you get that simple fact through your thick skull?
Jo glared back at him.
So what has been stolen?
Miller hesitated and then shook his head.
That's none of your business.
Make your mind up. A moment ago it was very much my business. You can't just...
Miller glanced sideways, his attention caught by something. A thin hiss escaped from his lips,
Christ, he murmured. Then, dashing straight out into the road, he stopped a passing cab and yanked the door open. Come on! Jo remained where she was. She looked at him, then back along the street. Two very large men were approaching from the direction of the Lumiere, both of them dressed in smart dark suits. If it hadn't been for the excessive amount of gold bling they're exhibiting, she might have mistaken them for hotel security. But these were clearly professionals of a different sort. Friendly wasn't the first word that jumped into her head. Like a pair of oversized grim reapers, there was an air of vicious determination about them. When they noticed Miller, they began to run. Helen, he yelled. Jo froze. What was worse? Getting into a cab with a man who was possibly deranged, or taking her chances with... Perhaps it was some kind of better-the-devil-you-know instinct that finally kicked in. However mad Gabe Miller was, she didn't fancy facing those two thugs alone. Chapter 5. She slammed the door behind her and perched on the edge of the seat. Her heart was pumping, slamming against her ribs. Straight on, Miller quickly instructed the driver. As the taxi pulled away, Jo gazed back at their pursuers. They were lumbering to a halt as they realised the chase was over. One of them took a phone from his pocket, flipped it open, and jabbed at the numbers. Who are they? Nobody you'd like to meet, he said. Believe me. Jo did. But she wasn't too keen on the company she'd chosen either. Moving as far from him as she could, she hugged her arms to her chest and hunched into the corner. Everything felt unreal, like a bad dream she was struggling to wake up from. Are you going to tell me what's going on? I was hoping you'd be able to do that. The cabbie leaned back in his seat.
Where to, Gov?
Well, Miller said to her, I presume you live in London. Where are we going? Jo shook her head.
We are not going anywhere. Just tell him where you want to be dropped off, and I'll take the cab on from there.
I don't think so, love. We've some serious talking to do.
I've already told you. I don't...
Spare me, he said. I haven't got the time. Either you choose somewhere or I will. Jo thought about it. She didn't want to end up miles from the flat. And even if she stopped the cab right now, Miller could get out too. She was safer in the taxi than alone with him on the street. As her overriding desire was to get home as fast as she could, she shifted forward and addressed the driver. Kelston, please. The station. Miller nodded and closed the sliding window so the cabbie couldn't hear any more of the conversation. Let's skip the games. We're both up to our necks and we have to figure out what we're going to do next. Our friends back there will already be searching for us.
For you, she insisted. Not me.
He barked out a laugh.
You may not have signed up to any contract, darling, but you're in this as deep as I am. You're involved whether you like it or not. I sincerely hope that whoever you're trying to protect is worth it.
Jo shuddered and stared down at her bag. She wanted to ring Laura, but couldn't while he was sitting right beside her.
It's not me you need to be afraid of, Miller said softly. It really isn't. I apologise for earlier. I didn't mean to scare you.
Yes, you did, she retorted. She might have been wiser to keep silent, but she couldn't. This had all become too nasty.
He lifted his shoulders in a slight dismissive shrug. You have to understand that what's been taken, well, it doesn't belong to me. I was only looking after it.
And that's a good enough reason to shove someone up against a wall, to threaten them?
Maybe not, under normal circumstances. But these are far from that. And please don't even try to deny that you deliberately set me up.
I didn't. You bought me a drink, that's all. I didn't force you into...
Miller snorted.
Are you kidding? You virtually threw yourself at me.
I did not.
As near as damn it.
He slapped a hand against his thigh.
For God's sake, Helen, stop messing about and give me some answers.
This has nothing to do with any blackmail plot, with any laptop, with any of that shit.
Then tell me what it is to do with.
He glared down at the floor. A few seconds passed before he looked up again.
What if I said silver to you? Would that mean anything?
Joe instantly thought of rubies, of the jewellery shop on the high street.
Silver what?
His dark eyes gazed unblinkingly into hers. Then, satisfied that she might be as ignorant as she appeared to be, he said,
You ever hear of a man called Vic Delaney?
No.
He's a businessman, of sorts. A few weeks ago, he employed me to retrieve, let's just call it an item, something that had gone missing that he wanted back. It took some time and a fair amount of grief, but I managed it in the end. We had a meet arranged for tonight at 9 o'clock. The hotel was a good place, mutual ground for the exchange. You know how it works. I hand over the goods, and he hands over the cash.
Joe wasn't sure how anything worked in Gabe Miller's world, but the concept wasn't too hard to grasp. So he was one of those guys back there?
Hell no. I can't remember when Delaney last broke sweat. They were just the hired muscle.
She instinctively jumped. Muscle suggested henchmen, which in turn suggested crime, violence, gangsters, and all those other dubious things she'd read about in the tabloids.
So why? Why did they get there so early?
Good question, he said. Presumably because some kind soul tipped him off that I wasn't going to be able to deliver. The same kind soul, no doubt, who got you involved in all this in the first place.
Laura wouldn't do that, she retorted.
Laura?
Joe turned away and stared out through the window. They were on the outskirts of the East End, winding through the back streets, and what she saw was as grey and as bleak as the thoughts that were running through her head. She knew exactly how and when she'd been drawn into this nightmare, but still couldn't understand why. None of it made any sense. She and Laura were friends, or at least she thought they were.
You need to start talking, Miller said.
Why should I tell you anything? Why should I trust you?
Because I just saved you from a highly unpleasant encounter with two very nasty goons. An encounter, I might add, that might have left you with a rather less pretty face than you have at the moment.
He paused. I could have left you standing on the pavement, but I didn't.
Give me credit for that. And to be honest, you don't have many options. Either you go on home and hope they don't catch up with you, or you do the sensible thing and tell me what you know.
Joe leaned even closer into the side of the cab. She felt sick to the stomach.
Okay, he said. You don't feel too happy about all this. I get it. I'm not exactly overjoyed myself. We've both been turned over for one reason or another. What we have to sort out now is what we do next.
Do?
She repeated glumly.
Tell me about this Laura.
You tell me. She's your ex. You were supposed to be meeting her in the bar tonight.
Miller shook his head. No. No on both counts. I take it she's a friend of yours. How long have you known her?
A while,
she said evasively. How long is a while?
Joe frowned. The truth was, they'd only met several months ago. Laura had come into Ruby's and they'd got chatting. She hadn't bought anything, but a few days later they'd bumped into each other on the high street and gone for a coffee. Whose idea had that been? She suspected it was Laura's, although she couldn't be sure. Since then, they'd been meeting up regularly, at least once and sometimes twice a week.
A few months.
Miller made a choking sound in the back of his throat.
Jesus, he said. Do you always go around planning robberies with people you barely know?
I didn't plan any...
Her objection fizzled out almost as soon as it had begun. There was no arguing with the fact that she had agreed to help Laura retrieve the laptop. She cleared her throat and carried on.
I mean,
I didn't see it as a robbery, more of a repossession. She was only taking back what was hers.
Except it wasn't hers, was it?
I wasn't aware of that.
Maybe not, he said.
His voice had a bitter edge to it.
But now that you do, it's time to start sharing what you are aware of.
Jo wasn't sure how to respond. She didn't like Miller, didn't trust him. But her loyalty towards Laura was beginning to feel rather misplaced too. It was dawning on her just how little she actually knew about her so-called friend. Laura had never spoken much about her life, and Jo, wrapped up in her own ongoing problems, hadn't thought to ask. After losing Peter, she'd become distanced from so many of her old friends, their awkward sympathy and embarrassment, matched by her chronic inability to overcome it, creating a barrier between them. With Laura, it had all been so much easier, a friendship based entirely on the present.
We could start with a surname, he said.
She sighed. James.
And?
And what?
I've never heard of a Laura James, he said. Describe her. How old is she? What does she do? Where does she live?
Jo hesitated.
Oh, for God's sake, Miller said. You don't owe her any favours. She's involved you in a robbery, done a runner, and left you to face the music. She stitched us both up.
If I can't track her down, if I can't get Delaney's property back, then we're... He stopped, sighed, and closed his eyes for a second. When he opened them, they had that pleading look in them again. Jo stared at him. She had the impression that he wasn't a man who was easily scared, which made his current expression even more disturbing. If this silver thing has been stolen, why don't you call the police? As if her level of stupidity had just gone off the Richter scale, Miller glared back at her.
Haven't I made it clear? Delaney isn't the type of guy who likes the cops involved in his business. But fine. You call them if you want. You've got a phone. Go ahead and use it. Dial 999. I won't stop you. You can explain all this to them. About how you tried to set me up. How you plan to steal from me. I'm sure they'll be very understanding. Of course, I can't guarantee how Delaney will react. It'll be entirely up to them to protect you from his less than pleasant temper. Let's hope they have the necessary resources. Jo didn't even look at her bag. Never mind take out her phone. Delaney aside, and it was a big aside, she had a dreadful image of walking into Kelston Police Station and coming face to face with the vile Sergeant Hannon again. After the business with the letters, she could imagine how he'd react. He'd already got her classified as some kind of nutter. We're running out of time, Miller urged. And yes, I understand you don't know me from Adam, but it strikes me you don't know this Laura too well either. If nothing else, you could give me a description. That's not too much to ask, is it?
Okay, she snapped back. She's a bit taller than me, about 5'6" or 7". In her late 20s, attractive, slim, long brown hair, hazel eyes.
Great, he said. Very helpful.
Jo shrugged. I don't know what else to tell you.
Anything, he said. Any minor difference that might distinguish her from all the other lovely brown-haired girls out there.
Jo tried to conjure up a picture of Laura in her head. No, there isn't. She stopped suddenly, recalling one small detail. Hang on, there is something. She's got a tiny chip in the corner of one of her front teeth. There was a second's delay before Miller went rigid, his whole body tensing.
This one, he said,
raising a finger to his mouth and tapping at his right incisor. Jo nodded. So you do know her? Miller didn't reply. She had the impression he was holding his breath. Then the frown lines on his brow dissolved, his shoulders loosened, and he slumped back in the seat.
Susan, he whispered. My God, I should have guessed.
Chapter 6. There was a moment as they got out of the cab, and he was passing over the fair, when Joe thought about asking for the driver's help. She could jump back inside and tell him to lock the doors. She could get him to drive her away from here. There was no way Miller could track her down. She was not sure what prevented her. Perhaps it was simply the fear of the unknown. If she was going to run, she wanted to know exactly what she was running from. And Miller was the only person who could tell her that. It seemed unlikely that Laura, or should that be Susan, would be doing much explaining in the near future. "We can go to Conley," she said, nodding towards the cafe.
"We need somewhere private. What's wrong with your place?"
But she didn't intend to be alone with him again. "That's not possible." Miller glanced at her left hand, at the finger with the gold band.
"Ah, right," he said. "I don't suppose the old man would be too pleased if you showed up with company, or if he knew what you'd been doing tonight."
Joe frowned, unwilling to disabuse him of the notion that she had a husband waiting for her at home, a husband who would undoubtedly raise the alarm if she failed to turn up. She wished with all her heart that Peter was there. She wished she could just rush into his arms and... But it was pointless to dwell on empty longings and shattered dreams. She was on her own. There was no one to fall back on. "Connolly's will be fine," she said firmly. "It won't be busy." Miller didn't make any further objections. They walked side by side to the cafe and passed through the heavy glass doors together. Inside, as Joe had predicted, there were only a few other customers. They chose a table at the very rear of the room. He took a seat from where he had a clear view of the entrance. A young bottle blonde with a red slash for a mouth sashayed over to them. She was wearing a black T-shirt and a very mini skirt.
"What can I get you?"
"Two coffees," Miller said.
"Espresso? Cappuccino? Latte?"
"Just plain old coffee, sweetheart," he said, before she could recite the entire list. "If the damn stuff still exists."
The waitress looked him up and down, clearly approving of what she saw. She smiled, moved forward, and put a hand on her skinny hip.
"Two plain old coffees,"
she repeated, before dropping her voice into a huskier, more provocative tone.
"And is there anything else you'd like?"
Joe raised her brows. The girl's leg was almost touching Miller's. If she got any closer, she might accidentally fall into his lap.
"Not right now," he said. "But if anything comes to mind, I'll be sure to let you know."
Her red lips formed a sultry pout before she turned on her heel and strutted off. Miller made a brazen study of her long legs as she headed towards the counter, then transferred his gaze back to Joe.
"Well, there you go," he said. "Perhaps this might not turn out to be the worst night of my life after all."
She scowled, wondering at his ability to be thinking about sex at a time like this. The man had all the restraint of a dog on heat. "What happened to urgent? A while ago, you couldn't wait to talk." As if her antagonism might be down to a latent form of jealousy, Miller grinned.
"Oh, don't worry, love. You have my full and undivided attention."
"So tell me what's going on."
"Now I know who we're dealing with."
He placed his elbows on the table, half closed his eyes, and then, as if he was rolling through the thought in his head, slowly nodded.
"Yeah, it's not as bad as it could have been."
"Care to enlighten me?"
"Care to tell me what your real name is?"
Joe flushed.
"What makes you..."
"No offence, Helen, but you're hardly the best liar I've ever met. And you weren't too well prepared either. Back in the bar, it took you over 5 seconds to even come up with a name."
"Fine," she huffed defensively. "I suppose being a good liar is considered a bonus in certain social circles, but some of us have different values." Miller's gaze fixed on her.
"As you barely know me and have no real idea of what I value and what I don't, I'll put that particular insult down to stress."
Joe's cheeks turned a deeper shade of pink. Hearing the affront in his voice, she almost regretted what she'd said. She was tempted to apologise, but then, recalling what he'd done, remembering the way he'd shoved her back against the wall, had second thoughts. "Whatever." He continued to stare before his mouth gradually slid into a smile again.
Do you take everything so seriously?
She glared back at him. What's not to be serious about?
You're not going to start blubbing, are you?
It was only as he said it that Jo realised how close to tears she actually was. She could feel her eyes beginning to water. A lump was expanding in her throat. Why should I do that? I mean, it's been the ideal Friday night. First I get to spend some quality time with you. Then I get abandoned by a so-called friend. Later, I learn that I'm on the run from a crazy gangster over something I don't have a clue about. And now I'm sitting in a cafe listening to you telling me that it's not so bad after all. Who could ask for a more perfect evening?
I guess that's one way of putting it.
Have you got a better one?
You're not entirely innocent in all this, he said.
Did I say I was? The waitress arrived with their coffee. Before she was forced to witness another of their overfamiliar exchanges, Jo stood up and headed for the ladies. Excuse me.
There isn't a window in there, is there? Miller called out after her. She didn't bother answering.
Chapter 7. Jo splashed her face with cold water, patted it dry and stared into the mirror. The blue eyes that returned her gaze were filled with dismay. How had this happened? Why? As the truth sank in, her frustration was gradually being replaced by anger and resentment. Yet a part of her was still unwilling to accept what Miller was telling her. She took out her mobile. One last chance. She pressed in Laura's number, raised the phone to her ear and waited. Anticipating the beep, she readied herself to leave a message, but instead she just got a continuous tone. The line had been disconnected. Then she had another idea. Digging out a pen and a scrap of paper, she called a directory inquiry service, gave them the details for Hopkins, Ridley & Co., and asked to be put straight through. It only took a moment. She listened to a recorded message telling her that the office was closed, but that a solicitor could be reached on the following number. She quickly scribbled it down. It was a man who answered the phone, his tone brisk and efficient.
Anthony Morris?
Oh, hello, Jo said. I'm trying to contact Laura James.
I'm sorry?
Laura James, she repeated. It's urgent. I really need to talk to her. I understand she's a solicitor with Hopkins Ridley.
I don't believe so.
Jo knew it was pointless, but she persisted anyway. Are you sure? You don't know anyone by that name? A sigh drifted down the line.
Yes, I'm absolutely sure. But if you're in need of representation...
No, she said. It's okay. I'm sorry to have bothered you. I must have made a mistake. Jo hung up and put the phone back in her bag. She looked in the mirror again. The truth was staring her in the face. She was a fool. She'd been duped, taken for a ride, and she hadn't seen it coming. Just how gullible did that make her? For a moment, she leaned forward, her hands gripping the edge of the cool white sink. She felt the coldness running through her, turning her blood to ice. But Laura was her friend, wasn't she? No, she wasn't. She couldn't be. But how could that be true? How could all those months of chats, of shared confidences, have meant so little? In a gesture of anger and frustration, Jo picked up her bag and hurled it across the lavatory. Breaking open, it spilled its contents across the floor. She stared at the mess, before bursting into tears. Back at the table, Jo sat down and carefully raised the mug of coffee to her lips. She could have done with something stronger, but caffeine was better than nothing. Miller gave her a sly look.
I take it there was no reply.
What makes you think that?
Just call it a hunch.
Jo wasn't in the mood for his hunches. Laura's betrayal had cut her to the quick. Why don't you just say I told you so and get it over with?
Perhaps I'm not the type who likes to gloat.
Somehow I doubt that. He sat back, looking almost too disgustingly relaxed and casual.
My, I have made a good impression. You know what I think? Seeing as fate has seen fit to throw us together, we should make the effort to be nice. Let's start again. I'm Gabe Miller. Pleased to meet you. She ignored him. Now you're supposed to give me your name? I believe that's how it works in polite society. Jo shrugged. She was unwilling to reveal any more than she already had. Miller suddenly leaned forward, grabbed her bag and started to root through it. Hey, she said, trying to snatch it back. What are you doing? But it was too late. He'd already got her purse out and was staring at her driver's license. Mrs. Josephine Strong, he said, reading off the details. 12 Barley Road. That's quite close to here, isn't it? She glared at him. You had no right to do that. He dropped the purse back into her bag and pushed it across the table. You know my name, he said. Why shouldn't I know yours? What do they call you? Josie?
None of your business.
Don't be like that. Okay, I'll just call you Josephine.
She gave him another black look. She loathed the full version of her name. Joe, she admitted reluctantly.
He grinned. Well, Joe, now that we're on real first name terms, we need to get on with the problem of finding Susan Clark. I don't suppose you've got anything as useful as an address.
She didn't answer.
Look, the quicker you tell me what you know, the sooner you'll be rid of me. That is what you want, isn't it?
Joe couldn't argue with that.
She told me she lived in Docklands.
Miller waited. And?
I don't have a street name. I never actually went there. We always met up in Kelston. She said she was a lawyer, that she worked for one of the local firms.
He gave a soft laugh.
I bet she was pretty convincing, too. I wouldn't be too upset at being taken in by her. She's very good at what she does.
Conning people?
It's more complicated than that. She's more complicated.
You say that as if she means something to you.
She does. Did. Once upon a time. We were an item for a while, so she wasn't lying when she described me as her ex. If it helps, I don't think she intended to cause you any grief. She couldn't have known that I'd catch up with you.
Is that supposed to make me feel better?
Better than I feel knowing that she tipped Delaney off. His guys don't mess about. If I hadn't legged it as fast as I did, I wouldn't be the perfect physical specimen you see before you now.
Jo curled her lip.
You obviously made a good impression on her too.
Yeah, I'm beginning to realise that.
So are you going to tell me about this thing she's stolen?
Miller reached into his pocket and took out a slip of paper. He pushed it across the table.
This was left in the room at the hotel.
Jo looked down. The note was short and to the point. The price for safe return is £500,000. Her eyes widened.
That's a lot of money for a piece of silver.
Delaney thinks it's worth it.
You've talked to him?
Only briefly. But obviously he'll pay whatever it costs to get...
As if about to say something he shouldn't, he stopped abruptly and looked away.
She wondered what he was holding back.
I take it there's something dodgy about this silver article.
You're better off not knowing.
Oh, come on. You're the one who keeps harping on about telling the truth. You can't keep me in the dark. I'm already involved. You said so yourself.
Miller was still watching the room.
All right, he said, eventually meeting her eyes again. I'll tell you if you promise not to overreact.
Her heart did one of those nervous flips.
Why should I?
His gaze held hers, but he didn't immediately reply.
All right, she said. Fine. I promise.
He hesitated for a second.
What you need to understand is that silver isn't exactly an article.
What do you mean?
Are you sure about this?
Yes, she said impatiently. Just get on with it.
Miller took an audible breath, made another quick survey of the surrounding tables, and then leaned in so close there were only inches between them. His voice was barely a whisper.
Silver's a girl. a 14-year-old girl. She's Vic Delaney's daughter.
Joe's mouth dropped open. Chapter 8. Her mouth was still open 15 seconds later, her brain desperately trying to absorb the information. Assailed by an ongoing battering of shock, confusion, fear, and disgust. No was the single word that kept revolving in her head. A girl? Laura's taken a girl?
Keep your voice down, Miller said. You want the whole calf to hear.
Jo covered her face with her hands.
She can't have. She couldn't.
She has.
But why?
Why do you think?
Picking up the slip of paper, he flapped it in front of her. This is what's commonly referred to as a ransom note. She peered between her fingers and groaned.
Oh, God.
I thought you were going to stay calm about this.
Jo dropped her hands and stared up at him, his callousness having the useful effect of jolting her thoughts back into some kind of order.
Jesus, she said. You told me you'd been robbed. You referred to that girl as an item, a thing, a piece of property.
It was just a turn of phrase. It wasn't meant. I had to be careful. I wasn't sure how much you knew.
You talked about retrieving her, about a meeting with Delaney. He was supposed to pay you, cash on delivery, right?
She stared at him.
What the hell did that mean?
It's a long story.
I'm sure it is.
What she was equally sure of was that having a 14-year-old girl in your hotel room, a girl you were being paid to return, went way beyond the dubious.
It's not what you think, he said.
You don't know what I think.
I can take a pretty good guess. It's written all over your face. You've already decided that I'm some kind of pervert, but you shouldn't go jumping to any conclusions. If you just give me a chance to explain to...
What for?
She shook her head.
I don't even understand what we're doing here. This is a young girl's life we're talking about. We have to go to the police.
Miller raised his eyes to the ceiling. We've already been through all that.
Hardly, she protested, astounded by his attitude. You weren't exactly straight with me. This changes everything. Surely even you can see that.
Susan isn't going to harm her. I know what she's like, what she's capable of, and what she isn't.
And if you're wrong?
I'm not, he said firmly. Silver's perfectly safe. I'd put my life on it. And if I can find Susan, if I can track her down quickly, then there's a chance I'll be able to sort this before anyone gets hurt. But if you insist on involving the cops, it's going to make my job 10 times as hard, maybe even impossible.
Jo wasn't convinced.
You mean the police are going to want to know what you were doing with a 14-year-old girl in the first place?
What I mean is that the cops will screw it up. Despite what you may think, I don't have anything to hide. But they'll be all over Delaney, about which he won't be best pleased. And I'll be spending hours in some lousy police cell.
So this is all about saving your own skin?
Yeah, that's it.
He gave an exaggerated sigh.
That's why I jumped in that cab and left you standing in the street. That's why I'm sitting here now telling you all this and trying to figure out a way of sorting the problem. Let's face it, love. I could be miles away if I wanted to be. Somewhere Delaney and the cops would never think of looking.
Fine, she retorted. But that poor man's still missing his daughter. He has the right to know who's taken her. He must be worried sick, and we're just...
He brought his hand down on the table.
Will you just open your ears and listen? Maybe in your narrow, righteous universe, the truth is everything. But Delaney's world is a different one altogether. I wouldn't waste too much sympathy on him. He's not so generous with his own compassion. Silver isn't the issue here. She's not the one who's in danger. Susan is. What you need to understand is that she won't be able to pull this off. At some point, she'll make a mistake, a big one. And then he won't think twice about meting out his own brand of justice. Would you like me to spell out what that means? Or can you take an educated guess?
Jo's head was beginning to swim again. She'd never met anyone like Gabe Miller before. Someone who could turn almost any argument around and make their own twisted logic sound perfectly reasonable. And it wasn't just his mental agility that bothered her. She was suddenly aware of how physically strong he was too. He was the type of man, she imagined, who wasn't used to being contradicted. "I have to find Susan before it gets that far," he continued. "You can help me or not. And if you can't, or you won't, you can at least do me the favour of keeping your mouth shut for the next few days." Jo couldn't contain her scepticism. "You seem more concerned about Susan than the actual victim in all this." "Perhaps that's because we have differing opinions as to who the actual victim is. I realise that you're probably not feeling too sympathetic towards her at the present, but do you really want her dead?" "That's not fair." Jo couldn't deny that she was angry at what Laura had done, how she'd used her, but that was a far cry from what Miller was suggesting. She knew she was being manipulated, forced into a corner, but she was still determined to get some answers before making a decision. "Perhaps it would help if you explained what Silver was doing in your hotel room."
"If that's what it takes."
"I'm listening." Miller folded his arms on the table. He leaned forward again.
"Okay," he said. "What you need to understand about Silver is that on top of being your normal troubled teenager, she lost her mother when she was a kid and has a bimbo stepmother young enough to be her sister. Add into the mix a father who rarely takes much notice of her, and you're probably beginning to see the picture. Delaney gives her all the material possessions she wants and enough cash to get her into the kind of trouble that he then resents her for. But that's as far as it goes. When it comes to any kind of relationship, he doesn't have a clue."
"But you do."
He raised a hand and dropped it back down.
"Is there any point to this? You've already made up your mind."
"And who's the one making presumptions now?"
Miller shrugged, thought about it, and carried on. "What Silver has got in the habit of doing when she wants some attention is running away. This was her third great escape of the year. She doesn't usually go far or make it that difficult for Delaney to find her. But this time was different. About a month ago, she nicked a couple of grand from Daddy's safe and took off with a no-mark called Richie Naylor. He's 19 and a user in every sense of the word. Delaney didn't hear from her and started to worry. That's when he called me in."
"And you tracked her down?"
"Eventually," he said. "She was holed up in a B&B in Blackpool. A nasty backstreet dive with nothing to recommend it other than the price. Richie, unsurprisingly, had bailed as soon as the cash ran out. And with his habit, that hadn't taken long. As you can imagine, she was feeling pretty sorry for herself."
"So you dragged her back to London and kept her in your hotel room?"
Miller's eyes flashed. "I didn't drag her anywhere, and I didn't force her into doing anything she didn't want to do. Let's just say that we talked it through, and I managed to persuade her that coming back, although it might involve a small loss of face and a few apologies, was still a better option than staying where she was."
"Mr. Diplomacy," she said.
"Whatever." He shrugged again. "I've been called worse."
"So why not take her straight home? What's with the whole hotel business?"
"We weren't sharing a bed, if that's what you think."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.